See, I don't know how, but there's power when I'm on my knees. I can be in a crowd or by myself. Talk with God. He is Emmanuel. When I close my eyes, no darkness there. There's only light. I get on my knees. I get on my get on my knees. There I am before the love that changes me. I don't know how, but there's power. I don't know how, but God gives me power when I'm on
your knees is a good place to be when you need to hear from God, isn't it? Well, welcome to Signs and Wonders. It's our real life Signs and Wonders Friday edition. We are so glad you're joining us. We're believing for signs and wonders for you today. You know, signs and wonders, there's things that we don't expect. There are things that we can expect in the Lord, but we never know quite what they are, because God is an amazing God and He does amazing things when we call upon Him. I'm Tom Hollis. I'm your host today, and I'm joined by Pastor Myra Bell. Yeah, so good to have you. And Amanda Brocker.
Amen.
And Sydney Goldman.
Happy.
Pastor Gary and Pastor Jay are off today, and we wish them well. But we want to see God move in a special way in your life. And, you know, that song, I just want to talk about that song for a minute, ladies. That when we are in that position of on our knees, you know, a lot of times we don't pray on our knees. We just stand up, we say a quick prayer up to the Lord while we're in the car or something. But when we're really desperate, we hit the ground, don't we? And we're on our knees and we're like, I can't do this, Lord. I have got to have you. I'm on my knees and I am not gonna get up until I get an answer. That's where we need to be.
That's right.
Yeah. There were times I did not know how to pray. And it, just to paint the picture, at this specific moment in my life, my 18-year-old then son was in psychosis, and I did not know how to pray. Mm-hmm. And it was like, in other words, he's like, Mom, make it stop. He would be in and out. And I'm like, I believe, do you believe? You know, and you got the devil being like, what you believe doesn't work. And you know what, all I could do was just get on my knees in our living room and praying, Holy Ghost. I was exhausted. I had no other words that I could say in English. And it was like, God, I need you right now. And I think when we put ourselves on our knees, it's a divine positioning. Sydney's been on her knees. You went on your knees in a program, and it just ministered so tremendously to our audience. But I mean, that's our position, is to be on our knees throughout our life. I think we have to live not that we can walk around on our knees, but I mean, I really think we have to live in that position because we need God.
Yeah. And if you remember Jesus saying, pray without ceasing. How can you do that and live your life? But in that position in your heart or prostrate before God in your heart.
Yes.
And if you live in that place, that's a place of humility.
Yes.
That is a place of humility. And that's where God wants us. That's where God wants you. In a place of humility, a lot of times we think that prayer is just talking to God. But listen, it's communicating with God. Sometimes we have to close it down and be quiet and just listen to what God would say. I think about Elijah. He was in that cave and God told him to come out. He had the wind come, all the storms come, and he thought God was in it. But how God was in that still small voice.
That's right, absolutely. You know, it's not the position that we normally think that we should be in. We're supposed to be able to take care of ourselves, right? We're supposed to be strong. We're supposed to, you know, stand up for ourselves. But that's not the position. The kingdom of God's completely upside down. You know, it's completely different from the kingdom of the world. And the kingdom of God says, when we are weak, He is strong. That's what matters.
That's so true. And I love like what you're saying, Pastor Myra, too, about, you know, just being on our knees. And, you know, when I was listening to the song that Barb was singing, like God reminded me of the Greek word. It's like proskuneo, which means to prostrate yourself before the Lord. And I just encourage you, if you're in your living room right now, in your bedroom, wherever you are, just take time out to just prostrate yourself before the Lord. Mm-hmm. Proskuneo yourself. Be on your knees. There is no better place to be on your knees. It reminds me of that song, This Is Where I Fight My Battles. The best battle, even what Amanda, you were sharing when you were going with your son and you just got on your knees. That's how we fight our battle. Sometimes there's no words you can say. There's nothing that you can speak. But I'm telling you, when you get on your knees, like God sees that. He sees that this is you're surrendering your flag and you're saying, God, fight my battles for me. And I'm doing it right here on my knees.
Yeah. Amen.
That's right. And we want to be part of fighting the battles with you today. So we have prayer partners standing by. We always do. But especially on this program, we want to make sure that you get a call through. So you can call 888-665-4483 and pray with one of the prayer partners and have that connection. You know, these people come so that they can pray with you. And we want to just give them that opportunity to pray into your situation and to receive some ministry, receive some encouragement, maybe some scripture, something that the Lord is speaking into your situation.
Amen.
Amen.
Such a
Amen.
Good word. Well, we're going to camp there. I'm excited for this powerful word that you have that you're going to share, and we're all going to get to be a part of it, but it's going to minister to you. So you might want to grab your Bible, maybe your notebook. This is how I do Bible study. Sydney has her phone. You know, we all do our own thing, but I encourage you there at home, you know, be like with us right here in our living room and just allow the Lord to speak to you, but write some things down and spend some time with Him even after the program and chew on the nuggets that God gives you. It will be sure to bring enjoyment to your life and freedom.
And I think about the Bible being on the top of the bestsellers list years and years and years and years because it's a living document. I mean, we'll say document because you can put it in your hands, you know. But God's Word is alive and powerful in our lives.
That's right.
It's able to discern thoughts and pull things apart, dividing apart that part that feels and that part that thinks so that we can do God's will. There is nothing like the Word of God. And it's I don't know how you all feel about it. But I know every time I open my Word, to read the Word, to study the Word, there is something that the Spirit of God will make alive at that moment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Every time, stories I've heard from a child, but how God will speak to you right there, right where you're at.
You know, I've read through the Bible several times, and every time I get back to a section I've certainly read before, there's something new. That's
Absolutely.
The Spirit of God. Now, also later, we're going to share the Word in a few minutes. And I do want you to get your Bible because we're going to kind of do it Bible study style here, I hope. And just to kind of read and talk, read and let the Lord teach us. But we also want to have communion with you a little later in the program. So we've got some juice and some bread here. And if you have some bread in the house, I'm sure you do, some juice or even water, something that you could just put together. We'll have communion together a little while later. We're expecting a great program. We're expecting a great move of God. So take the time to Just say, God, I want to hear from you today. I want to receive from you today. Lord, the situation I'm believing you for, I want to see your hand move in that situation. And we're going to believe with you. And we're going to be sharing the word in a little bit. Right now, we're going to go to a break.
Oh, draw me, Lord.
I pursue God by reading the Word of God to get to know who He is. And as I've done that, I've fallen in love with my Creator. He has so lavished His love upon me that I pursue Him with all of my heart.
I try to set time aside to be still, intentionally, and to acknowledge Him as God.
And I'll run after you.
The way that I draw near to God is I really press into His presence. You know, I love in Psalm 91, it says, you know, who dwells in the secret place will abide in the shadow of the Almighty.
I take time before I do anything else to get alone with God, spend time with Him in prayer, and get alone with His Word, and He never disappoints. He's always right there to meet me at the point of my need.
He loves us. He has a great plan for us, and He wants us to walk with Him.
You pursue Him by just opening the door and inviting Him in and letting Him make a difference in your life.
We're getting ready to go into the Word of God, and many times as we go into God's Word, we have to empty out ourselves. Empty out all those cupboards, all those places where we have things stuffed, so God can have His way in us. So tell the Lord, my storage is empty.
In me.
hope that's your prayer today, to have, that let God have his own way. And I pray that it is also your posture, that you are yielded and still, because when we're yielded and still is when God can begin to do something with us. When we're running around, we're trying to follow our own way, we're not yielded like that, are we? But when we are yielded, that's when God can really do his work. We want to talk to you today from out of Matthew chapter 6, and I do want to share this in a little bit of a Bible study format, just a kind of a teaching. I've asked everyone on the set here to be prepared. If the Lord has something for them in this time, let's just all dine at the Master's table here in his word. So this is how Matthew chapter 6, beginning in verse 25, it says, "For this reason I say to you, do not be worried about your life as to what you will eat or what you will drink, nor for your body as to what you will put on. Is not life more than food and the body more than clothing?" Well, let's talk about that, ladies, first, is that he says, "For this reason I say to you," and he had just got, so what is the reason? He had just got done saying that no one can serve two masters. Either you hate the one, we can't serve God and mammon or riches. And isn't that the way it is? That if once we are, once the word of God is in us, and that that God, once God is our master, then the situation's decided. We don't have to worry any longer about all these different things of what we're going to drink, what we're going to wear, you know, what we're going to put on, the clothing, you know. I think I got this Goodwill. I don't know. I like to go shopping. I like to find some clothes, that sort of thing. But we don't have to worry about that.
That's right. That's right. Yeah. It can be so distracting. I think that's why. If we're constantly thinking about what are we going to eat, you know, I've been around people like that. They live to eat. That's their conversation. Where is the next restaurant we're headed to? The family vacation's all planned out. We know everywhere we're going to go eat, morning, afternoon, and night. You know, some people are like that, but it can be a major distraction. Mm-hmm. Just as the clothing, you know, you might not feel adequate enough. So, then you're worried about the clothing. You got to go back in. How many outfits did I have on this morning? Well, I did go through a few. But anyhow, we arrived at a completed outfit, and here we are for real life. But it's like for me to put all of my time and effort into worrying about that, it's distraction. Keeping me from God.
Right. Well, let's go along then and look in verse 26. It says, "Look at the birds of the air. They do not sow, nor reap, nor gather into barns, and yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Are you not worth much more than they?" Boy, we do worry about our stuff, don't we? You know, we've got these places, these storage areas, you know, that just go, and you know, you've got your bedroom's full, and your basement's full, and your garage is full. I have a shed because my garage is full. Now I got a shed full of stuff, you know. And then if we want to go a little bit further, where do we go? We go rent someplace, right? We go rent someplace, and we, you know, for X number of dollars a month, you can store your stuff there and never look at it. Believe me, a lot of us never look at the stuff that's in one of those storage facilities. But, and I'm not saying if you need that, that's fine. But isn't it interesting? We gather into barns, don't we? But the birds, they don't. And Sydney, we can trust the Lord even when we don't have all this stuff stocked up.
You know, Tom, when you're talking about, I guess, like, as we're reading the scripture together, just thinking about, you know, gathering stuff, and I think, what's that lady's like Marie Kondo, and everybody's like trying to, you know, organize and take things out, but it's like so amazing that God, you know, we can just, when we put our trust into him, we just know that we have more value. There was one day I was actually sitting on my stoop outside of my apartment, and I remember looking at the birds, and God was just like, you have more value, you know, don't have to worry about things that happen in life, but he takes care of us. He's Jehovah Jireh, and when you lock into that, it gives you a peace that you don't have to run with the world. Because I know with my generation as millennials, there's a lot of comparison on social media, or if I have this or I have that. But when you like know your identity is in Christ, he gives you a peace. You know, he helps you to go through those things.
Absolutely.
And I love that. I love the way you put that, because we can be in such a rush going on, trying to find this and get this and get this. And when you're caught up in the day-to-day, like you said, you can't be in touch with God in the same manner that He would want you to be.
That's right.
So He said, don't worry about those things. The world goes after that. The Gentiles go after that. But I have something better for you.
That's right.
I have something better.
That's so good. You know, this next verse really, really hits me. Verse 27. And who of you, by being worried, can add a single hour to his life? And why are you worried about clothing? Observe how the lilies of the field grow. They do not toil, nor do they spin. And yet I say to you that not even Solomon in all his glory clothed themselves like one of these. So let's stop there for a second. That who can add a single moment to their life? No one can. And you know, I've heard it said that 99% of what we worry about never happens. It never happens to us. Right. We get so anxious and so concerned and so worried about so many things that just it tears us up inside. And just in the natural, they don't even happen. But with God, we can have peace. We can not worry.
Yeah. Think about this gentleman. He went and he got this like really expensive watch, you know.
Yeah.
Oh, big status symbol. But guess what? It didn't add 1 ounce of time to his life. Seriously, like when it comes down second by second, we have got to place God in priority. Mm-hmm. So that's what I hear in all this. Like, put me as priority. And that way you're not worrying about these other things that will pull you away from my focus.
Amen. That is really good.
You know, I was going to say, Todd, real quick about the lilies when you were talking. It's just, I'm loving how we're doing this together because it's giving me new revelation about the lilies. Like the lilies, you know, they're planted. There's a seed that's planted and they grow. They go through storms. They go through things. But they still look beautiful. You know, God is still, he's the ultimate gardener. And he's like, I feel like in the same way with us, no matter what we go through, no matter where we're planted in this season, where you're planted in this season, just know that God is with you. If there's the rain comes down or the sun's really hot or whatever that looks like in your life, that he is with us. So we can't worry. If he takes care of the little flowers, how much more is he going to take care of us?
That is so true, Sydney. It's so true. In fact, as it goes on to say, it says, in verse 30, but if God so clothes the grass of the field, which is alive today and tomorrow is thrown in the furnace, will he not much more clothe you, you of little faith? Do not worry then, saying, what will we eat? What will we drink? Where will we? What restaurants will we stop at on vacation? What will we wear for clothing? For the Gentiles eagerly seek all these things, for your heavenly Father knows that you need all these things. And isn't that the key here? Isn't that the key, Myra, that the Gentiles, I'll use that as the world, they're eagerly seeking after all these things. And we know that we need to live, and we need clothing, we need food, we need all those things. But for so many people, that's the top thing. But for us, it can never be.
Right. And as you were talking, I was thinking that we believe what God's word says. I mean, we do. We just say God's word is right. But when you're in the midst of that need or the midst of a situation or the midst of, and a lot of times when we get to that spot, we will say, well, I believe God. I believe God's word, but, and we'll add that but in there. So it's important for us to not put that but after God's word, but allow him. Sometimes he makes us or he allows us to go through the complete storm rather than stopping the storm. Mm-hmm. He fixes us. He changes us. Yeah. And many times I think about Romans 8:28, all things work together for good. For we know this. We know it. All things work together for good. So sometimes God allows us to go all the way through it so that we can help somebody else who's in trouble from comfort that we get, the fact that God met our needs in the midst of the storm, in the midst of the trouble, in the midst of being hungry.
That's right.
And many of us don't know what it is to be hungry or as the old folks used to say, old Zion used to say, when I get down to my last dime, he steps right in, right on time. Many of us don't know that place.
That's right.
But when you get in that place that you need God to meet those needs, he does it.
Yes.
You know, in this day, in this time when this was written, sometimes they didn't know where their meal was coming from. They didn't have stores of food like we do now. Right. They had to trust the Lord for it day by day. Mm-hmm. So let's bring this home. So we know it's easy to say all this. You know, it's easy to say, you know, don't worry about right. this, don't worry about that, everything's going to be all right. But as Myra just said, when we are in that situation, that's not so easy. And we've probably all been there. And we've been there where we've like, I don't know, Lord, I don't know. Right. And we've been out of work. We don't know how we're going to pay our bills. Or we don't know how we're going to, maybe we're working, but we get to the end of the month and the money's been gone for a week. And we don't know where that's all going end up. We don't know how. But here's the formula that Jesus is giving us here. Look at verse 33. But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. So do not worry about tomorrow, for tomorrow will care for itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Wow. Amen. Seek first his kingdom. Mm-hmm. Seek first the kingdom of God. So let me ask you that. How do we seek first his kingdom? What do we do?
Well, we're going to read our Bible. We're going to pray. We're going to worship him. We're going to go to church, get plugged into a local body, and do not forsake the assembling. But you don't know unless you don't start here and get yourself, you know, in the Word. You have to start somewhere. But going to church, to me, watching Cornerstone Television, of mm-hmm. course, you know, just to edify yourself and get as much of the Word in us. But I'm about to burst because I'm seeing the fullness of this. I'm having a moment. When we seek God, okay, so now I'm going to go to church. I'm seeking God. I'm going after him. Well, while I'm at church, I meet some people who they're living the Word of God. And it says in 1 John 3:16, by this we know love, because he laid down his life for us, and we also ought to lay down our lives for the brethren. But whoever has this world's goods and sees his brother in need and shuts up his heart from him, how does the love of God abide in him? My little children, let us not love in word and tongue only, but in deed and truth. And by this we know that we are of the truth and shall assure our hearts before him. So when you go to the church, you got people who see your need and they're able to help you, maybe by giving you some food or some clothing. I'm like, seek first the kingdom of God, because God uses people. He uses us.
Boy, he does. And that's so true, Amanda. That's another aspect of it. Mm-hmm. See, Jesus is setting us up to say, if you care about the things that I care about, if you put my kingdom first, seek first my kingdom, all those things will be added unto you. All those things you're storing into your barns, all those things that you're pulling towards yourself saying, I can't let this go. You know, you have to let it go. You have to let those things go. Trust in him. Let the worry go. It's not that you can't have a few things set aside, but you let the worry of it go. And then God ministers to you. Now, we want to pray for you in these areas. So I want to give you the number. It's 888-665-4483. There's a prayer partner over on the other end, and you're saying, you know what? I've been so burdened about where my finances are going to come from. I've been so burdened. Tom, you don't understand. I don't have enough money for my kids for the shoes they need for school. I don't know how I'm going to get through the summer now with my kids, and they were getting fed at school, and now we have to provide all of that. I don't know where that's coming from. I understand. I really do. And so God understands even more, though, and he has an answer for you. It could be finances. It could be relationships. It could be family. Whatever it is, you've been holding on and saying, I can't let go of this one thing. And the Lord says, seek my kingdom. Seek my kingdom, and I will provide for you. Amen.
There's somebody who's watching, and fear has gripped you so much, you have been afraid to trust God in those situations. And God is saying to you, start with the small things, and you will have a reference point. And then go to the next thing, the larger things. Each day has its own trouble. We just were reading. Each day, you're going to have trouble. I'm going to have trouble. All of God's children are going to have trouble. But we have someone who will carry
the load. We have someone who will see the end, who sees the end of the thing from the beginning. And if we just put our trust in him, now we will put our trust in GPS, and sometimes Siri gets it wrong. Sometimes you'll be going around in a circle because of Siri. But listen, God leading you will never steer you wrong. So if you do seek him, you do all the things that Amanda said, and you do start applying God's word to your situations. Every single one. It's not too small. You're late for work, and you need to get there. You need to get a parking space. You need to catch that bus. God will slow a bus down for you. He will give you a parking space. Now, those are small things, but what happens is your faith will begin to build. And for the bigger things, the larger things, this God won't fail you. So trust him. Trust him. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, his standard of right. That's what righteousness is. Seek that first, and everything you need will be added on to you.
When you were talking about the bus and finding a parking spot, it reminded me of something that happened in my life when I graduated from college, and I had my first job. I was working as a production assistant in Philadelphia, and I had to catch the overnight bus. Okay, I lived in Philly. I had to catch the bus at 4 o'clock in the morning. Or I had to be, I think I had to work at 4 a.m., but I had to catch it earlier. And you know what's amazing is that, like, I saw God's people just step up for me in a way as I was like 22, 23 years old, you know, in the city of Philadelphia. And it just brings me a little teary-eyed because I remember I had to walk from my apartment to the bus stop. It never rained. It never snowed. I'm telling you, every single time I walked to the bus stop, it never rained. It never snowed. Nobody attacked me. I remember a police officer one time picked me up and drove me to the bus stop. I remember the bus driver knew who I was, and he would wait for me, and he would pick me up early. Yes. So I just get tears to my eyes because God will send people on your path if you're struggling with somebody. Right. He will stop the bus. He will speak to the heart of the bus driver to pick you up. He will have the policeman pick you up in the car. Like, God is with you and walking alongside of you. He will always bring people on your path. Right. And another thing I want to encourage you with is, even when I'm struggling, I'm like, okay, God, I don't know how this money's going to come through. Or God is like, you know, it's like, seek first his kingdom. Seek first the things. Love people. So I remember one time, another story. There was a lady, she had cancer, and she really wanted to go to a service at church, and I brought her to church, and I mean, it was a lot. She was, you know, had the breathing tube, all those things, and I mean, I didn't have much gas, so we were kind of struggling a little bit financially. I kid you not, after I dropped her home, I got to the dollar store to pick up some things. There was a $20 bill. on the ground after I did. So I know that God, I mean, I know those are like funny stories, but the little moments that God has just showed me that when you seek him, when you just put your trust in him and just lay it all down, or maybe you're on the streets, you know, reach out to that homeless person, reach out and just show love and just watch how when you love on people, when you do what God is calling you to do out of, you're like, you know what, I don't have much, but this is it. This is my offering. God will see it and he will provide.
That is so good. I love that. I was thinking, it made me remind me of a story when my car was overheating. We're on an interstate in Connecticut or something. We pull off the exit, and I'm like, oh, Lord, let there be something here, you know, to help the steam coming out. And there's no businesses at all. It's all residential. We come to the only business. It was Casey's Radiator Shop, okay? So Casey was there, exactly what I needed him to be. So God is able to provide like that, right?
Yes.
God is able to provide exactly what we need at the time that we need that radiator shop right where we needed it. And you know what? God is able to do that for you today, whatever that is. You know, do you need something in your family? And you say, I can't. I've been trying. I've been believing. I've been trusting, and I don't see it. Continue to trust. Stand firm. Not just trust and wait. Seek first. You know, I was thinking about the birds that they're provided for. I watch them in the front yard. The cat watches them too, you know, but I watch it in the front yard, and they're working. They're out there doing something. They're not just staying in the nest saying, hey, God's going to feed me. It says right there, and you know, it says right there in Matthew, God's going to feed me, so I don't have to do anything. No, they're going out. They're doing what they can. But God provides for them as they go about their business, as they go about doing what they're supposed to do. So that's a word for us today too. Do what we know to do.
Sure.
Do what we know to do. Walk in that. And God's going to provide everything to take us to the next step.
This is such a powerful program today. You know, something that I've dealt with where worry and anxiety came up, God really had to help correct me because, you know, things are happening and sometimes other people are involved. Mm-hmm. So you got your own will that you're making submit to the Spirit, but then you're dealing with other people's will. And oh, Lord help me. It was another knee moment. I get down on your knees, but God told me in His Word in 1 Peter 5, and He said, God resists the proud. And it was like the Lord gave me a little whooping because if I'm worrying about something, then in a way I'm being proud, and I never thought of it like that. I'm telling God, I don't believe that you can actually take care of this situation, so I'm gonna deal with this. And it was kind of like, oh, you are? Well, read the rest. He gives grace to the humble. Okay, second thought. I don't have this figured out. Let me get back down on my knees. Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that He may exalt you in due time, casting all your care upon Him, for He cares for you. Do you know how much He cares for you? He loves you so much. It's the only reason of why He tells you, seek me first. Because He cares more about you than anyone, anything, any substance. My son dealing with addiction, it was almost like he thought that that drug had feelings for him. It's a very twisted thing. Yep. Yep. And so God is saying to each of us, lay it down. That's lay right. it down and seek me first. Today, I encourage you to pick up that phone, dial 888-665-4483. Talk to a prayer partner. Tell them the things that are giving you that stress and worry. And you know what they're going to give you? They're going to give you God's Word, His perspective on what you're going through. It's going to give you hope. It's going to position you where God's no longer resisting you. But He's going to give you grace because that's what He does for the humble. Right.
And as you were talking, I was thinking about it is so important to get rid of the fear. It is so important for you to get rid of fear because fear and faith can't operate at the same spot or in the same situation. It can't. Because fear is, if I can use this, my definition, fear is believing. It's a kind of faith in and of itself. It's believing that the worst is going to happen. It's believing that something negative is going to happen. It's believing that God won't take care of you. It's believing, yes, I believe that God will forget about me. We would never say that out of our mouths, but that's exactly what's going on when you have fear, when you hold on to fear. So when you let that fear go and begin to believe God, I don't know how you're going to do it, but I believe you're going to do it. Listen, what happens is hope starts to build. When yes. God does this one, you say, okay, God, you did that one. So now I have hope Thank for you, the Lord. Next one. See, faith is the substance of what you hope for. And it's important for you to let fear out of the picture. I was bound up in fear. I mean, I had so much fear. Now, this may sound funny to you, but I had so much fear of people, especially, that I would wash the, when I was a teenager, I would wash the windshield in the garage because I didn't want anybody to think I was crazy riding down the street. This one raised her eyebrows just now at me. I didn't want anybody to think that, I was crazy for washing my windshield and it wasn't raining or having the windshield wipers on. Fear, I had a fear of people and I would have to go to the restroom, but I wouldn't get up in church. I just would not get up. I'd stayed on the organ for hours and hours because I was afraid. But how God delivered me, and He wants to deliver you through this word. Trust God. He has not forgotten you. He is here for you right now, and He wants to work on your behalf. Amen. So let Him do it.
That's so good. The fear of man, it says, brings a snare. It can bind us up, that kind of fear. God wants to release you from that today. You know, the first thing you need to do, and we're going to be taking a communion in just a few moments. We're going to be praying for your needs at the end of the program as well. for everyone that calls into our prayer center. But I want to tell you, this is all just good talk if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You need to know Jesus as your Lord and Savior. You need to know Him. You need to be about following after Christ and put Him first in your life. So my question to you today is, do you know Him? Do you know Him? Have you made Him Lord and Savior? I did it by walking forward in my church. I knelt down at the altar and I said, ask Jesus to forgive me of my sins and to come into my life. And you know what? He did. I felt it. I felt something just lift off of me when I prayed. I was 12 years old. It wasn't even like I had this enormous life change at 12 years old. But you know what I did? I had an incredible eternity change at 12 years old.
Yes. Thank you. Yes.
So you can know for sure who Jesus is. You can know for sure where you're headed when the roll is called up yonder. That you will be with Christ, but you know what? You can live for His kingdom now too. So let's take this moment. If you've never accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior, why don't you just invite Him in? That's how you do it. You invite Him in and ask for forgiveness of your sins, which is just doing something wrong against God's laws. And we've all been there. All of us have done it. So we all need to be forgiven. So just pray with me. Say, Lord Jesus, come into my life.
Lord Jesus, come into my life.
Be my Lord and Savior.
Be my Lord.
Forgive me of my sins.
Forgive me of my sins.
Lord, I accept you as my Savior. I accept you as my Lord. And thank you for accepting me as your son. And as your child. As your disciple, Lord. I will follow you from this day forward. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. If you prayed that prayer, you can call the prayer partner right now and tell them I just prayed with Tom on TV to receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior. And they'll rejoice with you, pray with you, send you some literature to start you on your way, because it is the beginning of the greatest adventure ever. Well, we want to also have another great adventure. We want to take communion. And if you've got the elements with you, we just want to lift these up to the Lord. The Lord, on the same night He was betrayed, the scripture says, He took the bread and He broke it. And He said, this is my body. It's broken for you. You know, Jesus, He gave up everything for us that we might be forgiven, even His body. His body was beaten and broken because of our sin. It was put on the cross, nails put through His hands, through His feet, because of sin. Sin is bad stuff, and we've all entered into it, and we all need to be forgiven. So this is a reminder that He was broken that we might be forgiven. So let's take and eat of the bread together. Hallelujah. He also that same night took the cup. And He passed it out to His disciples and say, this is my blood that was shed for you. His blood was shed for the forgiveness of sins. No longer was there going to need to be all the sacrifices that were made in the Old Testament. You think about all those sacrifices. Every person had to bring in an animal for sacrifice, and there was blood all over the place. Blood on the altar, blood on the priests, blood on the floor. Just rivers of blood that can never take away sin. The bloods of bulls and goats can never take away sin. Well, why did they do it then? Because it was looking towards the one spotless lamb that was going to be offered once for all that we can be forgiven. And this cup is a reminder of the blood of Jesus that was shed that we might forgive. See, the penalty was paid that we might be forgiven. And that we might find forgiveness in Him. So let's take and drink of that now. Hallelujah.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, Lord. Well, I want to encourage you to continue to call. We want to pray for all those needs. There's a lot of needs. We're a needy people, and that's okay. It's okay for us to have needs. Whatever they are, God knows them. It says He knows what we need even before we ask. So we want you to get a hold of a prayer partner. We've got more here that have come in. We want to pray for you. I'll put everything down here. And we're just gonna take a moment and pray. But has anybody else got a word from the Lord of someone that's out there that they need?
I think what we just did in remembering, that's what communion is. He said, do this in remembrance of me. And I was like, oh, this is what seeking first the kingdom of God looks like. We just did it. It's remembering him, remembering what his body and his blood did for us. But I just believe God wants you free. This is a real event. This is not made up. Amen. This is a historical event, the life of Jesus Christ. Yes. And he is the only God that ever rose from the dead.
You see.
That's
he
right.
He ain't there in that grave anymore. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he's interceding for us. And he sent his Holy Spirit, and we have him, and that's why you don't need to worry. You don't need to worry about a thing. Consult God in everything. He will give you joy, peace, love, faithfulness, goodness, mercy, everything that you need to walk out whatever it is that you're walking through. And he loves you so much.
So good.
What a powerful day.
So good.
If there's somebody watching who you have been listening, but you have also been saying, mine is too big. Mine is too great for God. Now, you didn't say it with your mouth, but in your heart, you just have been thinking, it's too big. It's too big. But the scripture said, is anything too hard for God? Believe God and watch him work in that big thing that's the challenge for you, that has been a challenge for you to totally commit yourself to God. Allow yourself to let go and let God, as the expression goes. It's not too big for your God.
That's right. You know, people have called in and people have written in. And here's someone who is saying, pray for my daughter and that my granddaughter will forgive and forget. Boy, those kind of tearing apart of families. God wants to heal that. God wants to heal your family today. Do you have one, Sid?
Yeah, there's another family thing. We have Barbara. She said her second daughter, who's named after her, needs lots of healing, and she's far from God, and she's her daughter's an only child, and she said, please pray. The Holy Spirit woos her and teaches her God's love, because her daughter doesn't talk to her, and they had words, and she said she apologized. So there's a tearing of the family, especially with like mothers and daughters. And I just feel like my heart, it just like grieves my heart to know that people are wounded and hurting.
Well, let's pray together. We're gonna lay hands on these. We're gonna believe with you and for you, believe for your family. I'm gonna ask Sydney if she would just lift up these prayer requests to the Lord.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much, Holy Spirit, for every single person that is called in. And you know what's written, Father God. You know their name. I hear you know their name. And I pray right now in the name of Jesus, Holy Spirit, that you would descend into their situations, that you would be there, and that you would, everything that is broken, that you would just bring it back together, Father God, that there would be healing in households, Father God. We declare and declare there'll be salvations, family salvations will pour forth, Father God. People that are dealing with cancer, that you would dry up that tumor when they go to the doctor next, it'll be done. I pray for the spirit of depression, that it would flee from the minds of people, Father God, and the spirit of torment would go, and the spirit of anger would go in the name of Jesus, Father God. So we thank you, Lord Jesus, because of your blood that was shed on Calvary, that we have hope, that we can rejoice, and we know that you are working all things out for our good. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah. In the small notes of my Bible, it said, under worry that it divides. Worry divides. So we bind that division in Jesus' name. Yes. Cast all your care on God and have unity in your households. Glory to God.
I mean, we can go through a lot of problems when there's love and support around us.
That's right.
But all too often that love and support isn't there because the enemy has gotten in and he's caused us to have, you know, problems with our siblings, problems with our parents, problems with our children. And there's an unsettledness deep down inside. But God is able to give you the victory in that. We want to just make you aware of our address. If you'd like to write to us, Our address is on the screen there. It's 1 Signal Hill Drive, Wall, Pennsylvania, 15148-1499. You can also go to ctvn.org and you can leave prayer requests there. You can get in touch with us. We would love for you to do that. Great program, ladies. Hallelujah. We want to leave you with a blessing today. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you peace. Have great peace today. While we go over to Barb Rolla for the song, How Beautiful.
Beautiful. There's got to be a better way to do this.
There is. It's called Easy Pledge. Just sign up using your credit or debit card and your gift will come out on the same day every month. No stamps, no envelopes, no hassle.
That does sound easy.
It is. Just call 888-665-4483. You'll be signed up in minutes. Thank you for helping us share the good news of Jesus Christ.
Friendship is what we're all about here at Cornerstone, and we want to find out who you are. Our new Friends Club is a place to get to know us better so we can learn about who's watching us. If you've never reached out to us before, we have a book gift to welcome you to Cornerstone. You'll also receive our monthly newsletter. Just call us and tell the prayer partner you'd like to join the new Friends Club. They'll also pray and intercede for you and your family. Call us at 888-665-4483. Connect with us today.
Cornerstone Television wishes to thank all our faithful viewers whose consistent prayers and financial support have made this program possible.